This original WSRE presentation is made possible by viewers like you. Thank you.
For over four decades, she was Maria on Sesame Street. Sonia Manzano on this edition of Conversations. It was 1971 when a college student named Sonia Manzano landed the role as Maria on Sesame Street. For the young Carnegie Mellon University drama student, the role would be life-changing. For the next 44 years, Manzano made the character Maria an integral part of one of television's most successful children's shows. In addition to acting, she wrote for the program, a talent that earned her 15 Emmy Awards. Manzano's writing goes beyond television. She has written three children's books, No Dogs Allowed, A Box Full of Kittens, and Miracle on 133rd Street, a young adult novel, The Evolution of Evelyn Serrano, and her memoir, Becoming Maria, Love and Chaos in the South Bronx. She is also an accomplished stage actress. We welcome Sonia Manzano to this edition of Conversations. Thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you. My pleasure. I'm happy to be here.
What a pleasure to meet you.
Thank you.
How did you first get to Sesame Street?
Practice.
How do you get to Carnegie Hall practice?
No, not really. Actually, I was a student at Carnegie Mellon University, as you mentioned, and we did a show there called Godspell. Mm-hmm. You might know that show as well. And it was a student project at Carnegie Mellon, and they brought it to New York, and I came with the show and in my junior year of school, and the show became a big hit, and Sesame Street was one of my very first auditions as an actress in New York City. It had been on the air since 1969. It was first aired November 1969, when all kinds of fabulous things were happening. There was a moon landing that year as well, and I got the call to come and audition, and I was happy to come and comply. But I remember seeing Sesame Street at Carnegie Mellon in the Student Union when it first aired, and being absolutely mesmerized and shocked by James Earl Jones reciting the alphabet while the letters flashed over his head. It was really remarkable.
Wow. I want to show some of your work through the years. Okay. You spent 44 years.
Then I finally retired in my 44th year. And the short answer to why is 44 years was long enough for me to wait for Oscar the Grouch to propose.
Didn't happen, huh?
It didn't happen. And a woman has to do what a woman has to do.
Let's take a look at some of Sonia's work on Sesame Street.
Promise and don't make a fuss, we want you in the know. So just say hola, come on, say hola, instead of hello.
Hey, what's going on? What are you doing, Maria?
Oscar, I hope you're satisfied. You had to start all that stuff about Santa and tiny chimneys, and you've upset Big Bird so much he's gone.
Well, I didn't know he'd do anything dumb like that. I was only teasing him.
Teasing him?
Yeah.
Telling him that Santa's not going to bring anybody any presents because he can't get down a tiny chimney? Now, you call that teasing?
Well, he'll come back. He's part homing pigeon.
We are here today to celebrate the marriage of Maria and Luis.
On second thought, it's altogether possible I've made a major error. My hands are cold, my forehead's hot. It's either love or terror. I guess somewhere there's somebody who thinks a wedding's fun. But if I weren't five stories high, I'd run. Isn't he wonderful?
Maria, you'd think you were the only woman in the world to ever have a baby.
Susan!
What?
The car's gone.
What?
It must have been towed away.
What do you mean? It must have been parked illegally.
That's okay, Susan.
I'm sorry.
It wasn't your fault. But what do we do now?
Well,
get a taxi.
Wait a minute. I know. We'll get a taxi.
I just said that.
Yeah, I don't care. I didn't hear you. I don't care who said it. Somebody go get a taxi.
Okay. Taxi. Taxi.
Oh.
Here she comes.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, she's cute.
Wow.
Oh.
Let's see.
Oh, she's
Whoa.
What's your name?
Gabriela.
Oh,
that's a cute name. Mommy, could you take a break and help us with the conga?
Sure, I love the conga.
Oh, Maria's gonna help us with the conga.
Yes.
Yay! Now,
listen, it's a very simple dance. Just do what I do, okay?
Okay, Maria.
And you try it too.
What are you doing, honey?
Oh, I'm just...
It's a smoke alarm.
Alan, look! Smoke! Something's on fire in the kitchen.
I'll get the fire extinguisher.
I'll call the fire department. Come on, Elmo. Stay low and go.
Siete, rumba, rumba. Siete, siete, chiquito.
Sonia Manzano's work on Sesame Street. How neat is that?
That was great. That was great fun. I had fun participating in every single segment that we just saw.
I can imagine. What were the early days like?
They were exciting, thrilling, dangerous. We would have meetings with people from the community, and they would demand certain topics be taken and exemplified on the show, like nursing, for example. When I had my baby and nursed on the show, actually Buffy St. Marie was one of the first people to nurse on the show. But it was called experimental, and every year it was experimental because the needs of American children changed every year, and so every year the show tried to keep up with alleviating them and supplying them with what they needed to know.
When you say dangerous, you mean because people were threatening you?
No, one was threatening us. It was dangerous in that, maybe dangerous is the wrong word. I'm saying it was like we were right on the edge of doing exciting things. We were going to close the education gap. We were going to eliminate racism. I really thought that we were going to do that. I thought, well, now that we've labeled it and it's out in the open and the civil rights movement has happened, we're not going to go back.
Right, right.
All these races are going to die and then we'll keep going, was my understanding. So it was an exciting, idealistic time. Gotcha. The mood of the country was very idealistic, the exact opposite of what it is now.
Yeah.
It was a time when to show compassion was a good quality. Right. Now it's a sign of weakness or something in our society. And so, what I mean when I should not have used the word dangerous, I mean it was an exciting, idealistic time, and people were very passionate, and we would have various ethnic groups come and talk to us about how they wanted to be depicted on television. Sesame Street was groundbreaking. That was one of the first shows to have people of color on the show.
Right, right.
And in a real way.
Right.
And of course, when we were incorporating various ethnic groups, the Asian community had things to say about how they wanted themselves depicted, and Native Americans had something to say about how they wanted themselves depicted on television. So it was really cool. You go to all these meetings and hear all this wonderful stuff.
Well, you guys over the years really covered some, I don't want to say controversial, but certainly some important topics.
Yeah.
I mean, everything from death to 9/11. Elaborate on that.
Like, it's I'm, you know, there's never going to be a lack of material for the show. The most profound storyline that we tackled, I think, was Goodbye, Mr. Hooper. When Mr. Hooper died, Will Lee, the actor, passed away, and we wanted to explain his absence. And we did a lot of research as to what was out there for kids about death and came up with our own wonderful, wonderful, wonderful show. But since 9/11, as you mentioned, there have been even more terrible things and that the show has addressed. Then in response to 9/11, we did a four-part video called You Can Ask. There's a video on, there's actually a I don't know if it still has it, but Sesame Street had a website up that was like for stress management because the financial crisis caused a lot of children a lot of stress and concern. There's now the military families because so many mothers and fathers were both getting deployed over and over. And the last one was even children whose parents are incarcerated is another video that Sesame Street has put together. So kids are under a lot of stress these days.
Well, yeah,
yeah. As we all are.
I was going to say, that probably goes across the board.
I know, across the board, but, you know, we have to realize that as we suffer, they do too.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. You started writing for the show pretty early on. How did that come about?
It was, maybe I was on the show, eight years or something, and I wanted to contribute more, and acting is wonderful, but it's not the most powerful position to be on television, you know, and I saw that the directors and the producers and the writers were having a little bit more fun than me. And I had some questions about the Latino content, and as I asked the producers, why is it like this, or why can't we have more information, more in this direction. She said, Dulcie Singer, why don't you try writing some yourself? You know, at that time, there were no women writers. There were certainly no writers of color in the union, practically. So I really backtracked because I had to really put my money where my mouth was. And but I knew the characters and I knew the situations that were, and I knew that there was a curriculum book. That was shocking to me. She said, here, read this. And it was a thick book with all the curriculum. And the curriculum was what we were trying to teach kids and how they were going, we wanted them to understand. And it was our job to make it funny. Teach it and make it funny. So I did that, and I wrote the bits, and I waited till the last day of shooting in case it were really awful. We wouldn't have to face each other for several months. But they liked them right away, and that's how I became a writer.
Yeah. Well, you won 15 Emmys, so you must have had a little bit of a knack for it.
Yeah, I did have a knack for it. And it's part of the writing staff, I have to add to that. There's a bunch of writers, and I was one of them.
What makes a good television writer?
Well, I don't know what makes a good generic television writer, but I know for Sesame Street, you have to have a sense of humor. You cannot do this without having a sense of humor and a sense of being as real as possible for Sesame Street.
Because you really, I guess you really balance for Sesame Street. You want to be real, you want to be genuine, but at the same time, and maybe this is the wrong word to use, but I guess you have to be somewhat guarded because you are communicating to children, right?
Yes, you have to be careful what you say, but you also don't want to dumb down the product, and you want it to be sophisticated enough that an adult will watch and enjoy watching it, so that it kind of works on two levels. That's the best kind of writing.
Have you ever just sat back for a moment and just thought about the impact that Sesame Street has had on generation after generation?
I think I understand when people say to me, like, you don't know how much, and I think that I do, but when it keeps coming up, I think that if I really embrace the impact that it has on the show, I'd go to bed and I'd never get up again. That the show has had on people, I'd go to bed and never get up again. Since I've retired, I've gotten the most wonderful letters from people, heartbreaking letters, like, my mother was schizophrenic and my only hour of peace was watching the show and you on it. You know, or you were the first Latin person I ever saw in my life.
Really?
I mean, yes. So profound letters like that, that you think that you realize that you have made an impact on them. And let's not forget all the time they meet me and burst into tears. And I think I'm a catalyst. I think I've reminded them of sitting on their mother's laps and crying, watching the show, and they just fall apart.
Did you have a favorite episode, you personally?
Well, I think that probably my wedding was one of my favorite episodes on the show. Of course, that was the heyday of Sesame Street. That's my joke. Everybody says the heyday of the show was when they were getting all the attention.
Right,
and
right.
This is in the 80s when I was really getting a lot of attention and fell in love and got married. Maria paralleled my real life because I did fall in love and get married. Mm-hmm. And the point of it was not just to have a reality show, Latins were just getting on television at that time, but you always were waiting for the taco joke to come in.
Right.
And Sesame Street said, no, we want to show a Latin family that has the same hopes and dreams as any other American family. They want to have a baby, they want to raise their kid, they want their child to be educated, they want to go to the movies every other Saturday night. Right. And show the reality of the Latin community. We're worried about daycare. We had a daycare show and all of that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm. Let me switch over to your personal life. You've written your memoir. It's entitled Becoming Maria. Tell me about your early life.
It was very chaotic. I was raised in a household ruled by domestic violence. My parents came from Puerto Rico right after World War II and met in the mainland and married here. And they struggled. They struggled with the system. They struggled with speaking English. But they mostly struggled with each other. So there was, and this was at a time when domestic violence wasn't talked about. As a matter of fact, I remember the social initiative was that children should not come from broken homes. And my siblings and I would laugh about that because that's exactly what we wanted. We wanted them to split up so we would come from a broken home and thereby sort of try to live peacefully. In all of that chaos and all of the, we'd run away, we'd come back. My mother, would take us, we'd run away. I would find sanctuary and comfort watching television. I just would love, Leave It to Beaver and Father Knows Best and the Fred Astaire Ginger Rogers movie. So, of course, the first thing I wrote was me dressed up as Ginger Rogers dancing with the Fred Astaire in that clip that you just saw.
Is television, I guess, how you dealt with the what was going on in your family at the time, how you were able to overcome it, so to speak?
Absolutely, because you'd compare what you were watching on television. It was like this, you'd look out there into the world, the suburbs. We lived in a tenement area, and the suburbs were, I wonder where that is, where there's, people who, and then the school books were very Dick and Jane books. They were very middle class books that had nothing to do with my life. Oh, I wonder where that world is. And I think that I found comfort, but I wondered what I was going to do in a society that didn't see me. Somebody asked you, what are you going to be when you grow up? And you go, haven't seen anything lately that I could possibly emulate, but let me think. I'll get back to you on that. So anyway, I think it's interesting that I ended up being on a television show that was dedicated to reaching underserved inner city kids in the very beginning, which was the very thing I could have used.
Yeah, yeah. Was there a turning point in your life that you said, okay, that's what I want to be. I want to be an actress or I want to be a writer. Was there some magical moment?
I don't think there was a moment, to tell you the truth. I always loved, as I said, I love television. I love musicals. I love books. I love going into the fantasy world. I would try to do shows in my apartment, in our apartment. The Little Rascals would always do those great shows.
Oh, yeah. I remember the Little Rascals. Yeah.
And I would want to do shows like that, and not knowing they were professional kids. But anyway, so I always did like to. But the real reason I got into Carnegie Mellon University was because I wanted to go to college so desperately. And I'll just tell you this quickly. I was an A student in the inner city. When I got to the High School of Performing Arts, which is the Fame School, if you saw the movie, specialized New York City High School, my grades went from A to C.
Wow.
Because the difference in the education was so disparate. I was competing now with middle-class kids, and I just couldn't keep up. So when the time came to go to college, and I had a C average, I had to really think about how I was going to figure this out. So I went to schools that accepted you on an audition, the same way athletes go to college.
Right.
But I did like acting and sort of, you know, you kind of had to maneuver.
Right. What was it like for you when you got to Carnegie Mellon?
That was like being in Planet X. I had never been out of the Bronx, so.
I can imagine, yeah.
Going to Manhattan was a big deal, the right. High School of Performing Arts, and then going to Carnegie Mellon University in Pittsburgh was, you know, all these kids from the Midwest. You meet kids from all over the country. They didn't know what Puerto Rican was. I mean, Latins were invisible at that time. So they didn't know what to make of me. So I would go hang out in the ghetto of Pittsburgh. I would go to Homewood. But they would be private homes with barbecues outside. And I think, what kind of ghetto is this? There's no fire escapes. So, I mean, but it's wonderful. I think all children should leave wherever their immediate environment is to go away to school.
Get out of the comfort
zone. Get out of the comfort zone.
Yeah. I want to go back just for a moment on your childhood and talk about just a couple of minutes, some of the challenges you went through. I know what you referenced in your book, there was a time that your mother would actually hide the knives, I guess, like the steak knives or whatever.
I know.
In the house. Yeah. What was going
on? Well, here was the thing. My father would... I think he would like sort of, he didn't know what he was doing, you know, when he would have this crazed look in his eye. I could tell he wasn't focusing on what he was doing, and he would throw things and hit her with anything that was handy. And sometimes when he wouldn't get home early on a Friday night, which was payday, I'd watch her discreetly put every sharp object, all the knives in the kitchen, in the oven so that they would be out of reach. And then, of course, I'd ask her, why are you hiding the knives in the oven? And she'd say, what, me? Oh, no reason, just cleaning up a little bit. And so that was pretty funny. As a matter of fact, I was going to call the book Knives in the Oven until my nephew said it sounded like a Stephen King cooking show. But and I'm making light of it, but I of course it wasn't. It was horribly frightening.
Did your mom ever sit down and talk to you about it?
Sure. But parents, I was not being beaten, so she didn't understand why I was. She said, I thought that when you'd grow up, you'd understand. That's what she thought. Now, when I read about my mother's childhood in Depression, Puerto Rico, it makes Oliver Twist's life look like a walk in the park. The unrelenting poverty, the way children were disregarded and left at other people's doorsteps to be maids. So if you feed my kid, you know, she'll work for you. That horrible childhood that she and my father both survived, it doesn't let me forgive them, but I certainly understand that to them, they said, you have a place to live.
Right, right. All perspective.
We're feeding you. So it's all kind of perspective.
Yeah. Yeah, let's move on to something a happier note, if we will. You have written a lot. I mean, we talk about your success in television writing, yeah. But also you've written a young adult novel. Right?
Yes, yes.
And tell me about that, The Revolution of Evelyn Serrano.
Yes, The Revolution of Evelyn Serrano is historical fiction, and it takes place in 1969 when Sesame Street was first aired. And at that time... as I said, Latinos were invisible, and we weren't making any political statements at the time, even though there was a civil rights movement. We were still invisible. And a group in New York City called the Young Lords, a group of young men took over a church and wanted to feed the children of the neighborhood, in the Spanish neighborhood, oatmeal. And they wanted the streets cleaned up. They were young activists, and they asked all the old people who were playing dominoes, what do you want us to do? Do you want us to free Puerto Rico? And the guy says, no, we want you to clean up the neighborhood, try to clean up the garbage. So they went to the sanitation department and said, please come clean our neighborhood as often as you clean better neighborhoods or so-called better neighborhoods. They got no success until they set the garbage on fire. Then all of a sudden, everybody came. The mayor came, and all of a sudden, we were in the newspaper. So it was a moment for me that I embraced my Hispanic roots. Mm-hmm. They made us visible in New York City. And so the book is about a young girl going through those changes, coming of age in the midst of these people. And she's caught between a revolutionary grandmother and a docile mother. And she doesn't know which way to turn. Mm-hmm. And that's the turmoil on that. And that's really what the book is about. It's just the stories in the foreground of this political upheaval.
Well, we got about 2 minutes left. Just tell me a little bit about Miracle on 133rd Street.
Everything that I write is based on something that really happened to me. And one time my father came home with a huge suckling pig for Christmas Eve, which is how Puerto Ricans celebrate it. And he handed it to my mother, and she couldn't fit it in the oven.
Oh, no.
So he had to take it to the bakery that night. And so this is a little fantasy on other possible things that could have happened because this roast did not fit in the oven.
Great. And this is a picture book.
It's beautifully. Marjorie Priceman did the illustrations, and she's brilliant.
Now that you've retired from television, what's on your agenda?
I am absolutely busier than I've ever been before, visiting people's speaking engagements, and there's going to be several books from me published by Scholastic beginning in 2017.
Great. You enjoy writing, huh?
I love it. Yeah.
Will they? And it will all be sort of children's.
They're always children's, or young adult novels. Yeah. And I love to write because I'll just quote Loretta Lynn. And I watched her on PBS and American Masters, and they asked her. They said, "You sing about all these terrible things your husband did to you. I mean, why do you do that?" And she says, "Well, when I put it out there, it doesn't bother me as much." So I think that's why I like to write. I like to put things out there so they don't bother me as much.
Loretta Lynn, the great country singer. Yep, absolutely. Sonia, what an absolute pleasure visiting with you.
Thank you very much, Jeff.
You know her perhaps as Maria on Sesame Street for 44 years. Tremendous career. A lot of positive stuff in American television through Sesame Street and all that Maria and Sonia have done. By the way, you can keep up with Sonia at soniamanzano.com. For more of our conversations, well, you can find them online at wsre.org/conversations. We're also on Facebook and YouTube. I'm Jeff Weeks. Thank you so very much for watching. I hope you enjoyed the broadcast. Take wonderful care of yourself, and we'll see you soon.
Support for this program is provided in part by these corporate sponsors. And by viewers like you.